Yeah, this is a tricky question. So I want to move on to Angel's talk. Thanks a lot, Thomas. I had a question too, but maybe we can move other questions offline to the Slack or email. And let's turn to our second talk, which is, thanks very much. Let's give Thomas another hand for a nice talk. And thanks, Angel is going to give the second talk, Angel Aranga, on dynamical cobordism and swampland distance conjectures. So please, Angel, go ahead.
Okay, can you hear me? Okay, thanks a lot for the invitation and also for putting up this nice workshop. So I will be discussing about the cobordism and distance conjecture in a particular setup, which I'm calling dynamical, and I will explain what I mean by that. So this is based on these two papers with my collaborators, my students, and let me see what I can go on. Okay, and here they are. These are papers with Ginevra Buratti, Matilda Delgado, and Jose Calderon. One of them already published and one of them to appear. So let me just sketch the outline. I will be starting discussing what I will call dynamical tadpoles and what they have to do with cobordism. Then I will move on connecting that with the swampland distance conjecture, and then I will be done. So let me start with the cobordism, and in particular with the swampland cobordism conjecture, which states that any consistent configuration in a theory of quantum gravity should not have any cobordism charge. Otherwise, there is some exact global symmetry, and this is something that we expect is forbidden in quantum gravity. So basically, that means that for any consistent theory that we may have in mind, and the ones that I have in mind are string configurations, they admit they have to admit walls, that is boundaries on which the theory ends and space-time is has finite extent, at least at the topological level. So about walls of nothing, I don't mean that these are dynamical bubbles that can be generated or whatever. It's simply at the topological level. But there are many examples that are familiar to all of us. So for instance, in the n-dimensional N theory, we know that you can add a Horaba-Witten boundary with EA degrees of freedom and so on, but it's a location where space-time ends. And it's a boundary for the 11-dimensional theory. So similarly for type 2A, you can add oriented for eight planes and the eight brains, and you have like half of type one prime that corresponds to a boundary in which type 2A can end. And in compactifications, you can have similar phenomena, like if you compactify, let's say, type 2B on a circle and you put some particular SL2 set Wilson line, which is minus one in SL2 set, you know that you can end that configuration with a boundary, in a sense, which is just a disk ending on the circle, with some extra defects, which are oriented for seven planes and these seven planes. And there are tons of examples, and the conjecture says that for any configuration, you can find examples of boundaries for it. I should add that although in these cases, the cobordism defects for these walls of nothing are BPS, in general, they need not be BPS, and in many cases, not all these defects are not known. So there are many cases where you expect that there will be some defect, but it's not BPS, and then there is little handle on them. And typical examples are the walls of nothing that would exist for instance, 10-dimensional heterotic theories or type 1 theory, et cetera. Okay, another equivalent way to phrase this cobordism conjecture is that any two configurations in quantum gravity should be able to connect at the topological level by some kind of a domain wall. So if you have these two theories, like different compactifications, there is some kind of connection that you can cook up, allow the configuration to evolve in some direction by building this kind of bridge. And this represents a domain wall separated to two different theories, could be two phases of the same theory in some sense, or two widely different theories. The conjecture says that any two theories can be connectable, should be connectable in this way by some kind of domain wall, and they can be completely crazy things, but they should exist. Okay, so this conjecture is powerful, but it is topological in essence. So most of the consequences that you have by itself are just topological, but they are very powerful if you supplement this with extra ingredients. For instance, if you add the requirement that you're studying supersymmetric configurations, as in work done by Montero and Baffa, you can argue many things about the ranks of the real compactifications of any possible string theory and so on, and then work your way, for instance, towards string universality, say that any consistent theory of quantum gravity should be connected with a string theory in one way or another. So in this talk, I will discuss the co-partition conjecture, but connected with another ingredient, which is dynamical tadpoles. So I will explain what I mean by that. So tadpoles are not in the sense of Ramon tadpoles or the tadpole conjecture that will be discussed at some other talks in this workshop. So what I mean by tadpole is dynamical tadpoles, that is tadpoles for dynamical fields. And the point is that as soon as you have some theory which is sitting on the slope of some scalar potential, so it's not sitting at the minimum, but on the slope, you will have one of these dynamical tadpoles, that is a one-point function in the vacuum for some dynamical. That means that the vacuum is a source for that field, and then the theory does not admit maximally symmetric space-time solutions, like Minkowski or things like that. Rather, you have running solutions. So your consistent solutions to the equations of motion have to depend on some space-time coordinates, and this breaks maximal symmetry. So the plan is to look at this kind of evolving configurations, these running solutions, and try to draw some lessons, which may be fairly general for theories with gravity and this kind of tadpoles. And the plan is to focus on string theory examples so that we can learn from the theory what happens in the presence of these running solutions, these dynamical tadpoles. Okay. And the motivation to do this is that these kind of tadpoles they appear everywhere, in particular as soon as you break supersymmetry. It's a typical thing when you break supersymmetry that you generate potentials, and very often they are run away or are controlled, or the SUSY breaking happens when you're not sitting at the point that eventually will be a minimum. So it's interesting to ask what happens with these running solutions and what one can learn from them. Okay, basically for this talk, I will be focusing on space-dependent running solutions. Of course, time-dependent running solutions are very interesting for, let's say, applications to cosmology, but we are leaving those for future work. I will not be saying that much about them in this talk. Okay. The thing I will focus now is that these tadpoles have a lot to do with the co-partition walls of nothing. So the first observation, which is motivated by looking at dynamical tadpoles in large classes of string models, is that the running solutions have a finite extent in space-time. So there is some kind of a finite distance lesson, which says that the running solutions for these theories extend at most a distance delta, which scales in a particular way with the coefficient of the tadpole. Let's say the order parameter that tells you how much you're not sitting in the vacuum, what's the slope of your potential, if you wish. So basically the inverse of this space-time distance goes like the tadpole with some power, which typically for Minkowski or zero cosmological constant configurations is equals to 2. Okay. And the second lesson, this was already observed in a particular example by Dudas and Murad many years ago, early 2000s. The second lesson that one can learn from these running solutions in string theory is that the singularity that you encounter at this distance, below this distance is bounded by this delta, is some singularity which is typically resolved in string theory by one of these walls of nothing of the co-partition conjecture. So the space-time is cut off at this distance by some end of the world, which could be just end of the geometry, or it could be dressed with some decorated with some defects like brains or default planes or whatever. And basically it's kind of the appearance in a dynamical way of these worlds of nothing. Okay, so this is more or less the picture. Here you have a tadpole which is forcing you to run, then you run for a distance and poof, suddenly you have a co-partition defect, an end of the world, a wall of nothing that finishes off your space-time. Okay. And there are many examples that we studied in the already appeared paper, which are of many different kinds. For instance, the Klebanov-Strassler solution in the holographic compactification on ADS5 times T11 with three-form fluxes can be regarded as a wall of nothing in this compactification. So the three-form flux triggers the appearance of a tadpole. You have a running solution for a while, which in holographic in the holographic dual theory corresponds to running towards the infrared until you hit some singularity, which eventually is resolved by the Klebanov-Strassler growing up of the finite size 3 sphere. And you can find this kind of phenomena in many other compactifications, like in type 2B flux compactifications with NSNS and Ramon-Ramon three-form fluxes, magnetized D-brain models, 10-dimensional non-supersymmetric string theories like the OSP 32 non-supersymmetric theory, in massive type 2A, in M theory on K3 or Calabria compactifications, and so on. Today, I will not review all of this. I will just focus on these two because they will be useful to illustrate some further points that I want to emphasize beyond the already published ones. So I will focus on massive type 2A and also in M theory compactifications on K3 and Calabria O3. So let's start with the 10-dimensional type 2A theory with a Roman's mass parameter M. Okay, so this is formally just introducing a flux, some 0-4 field strength flux. And you can write down the effective action and see that there is a tuple for the dilaton that appears in here. Okay, so then this is regarded as a cosmological constant, but in fact, if you regard the dilaton as a dynamical field, this corresponds to some kind of runaway potential for it. So you're not sitting at the minimum and you have a tuple for that. So that means that you don't have maximally symmetric Minkowski-like vacua for this theory. Rather, you have running solutions. And the running solutions have this structure. They were studied many years ago. And you can observe that they have a finite distance singularity, finite distance in space-time, when this kind of a war factor, this function here, has a zero. This B is some kind of integration constant in the theory, but eventually you cannot run arbitrary long. Eventually you hit a zero, that means that you have a singularity. And you can compute the distance in space-time to the singularity, and you can see that it scales with the tadpole, with this quantity, in this particular way, according to the lesson that we were recalling before. The second observation is that what resolves this singularity is this dynamical Kobordisen defect of the Kobordisen conjecture, which is adding orientable eight planes and the eight primes. So you end up having something like half of type 1 prime theory, when you have this running solution for type 2A with a mass parameter, and eventually you hit this wall of nothing. And this is nothing but kind of reviewing in a particularly interesting way for our purposes, the Polchinski-Witten story of how in type 1 prime theory, you can develop singularities and eventually find unexpected gauge groups that match the heterotic theory compactification ones. Okay, but it's a particular realization of this story about dynamical tuples. And this is something that will be coming up in the new paper, is that the general Polchinski-Witten solution admits not only these walls of nothing, but also admits domain walls that separate different theories with different values of the tadpole parameter M. So you can regard them as interpolating Kobordisen, connecting two different theories or the same theory with different value of the flux or the mass parameter, if you wish. Okay. So in general, the solution, the running solution, has a similar structure, but it is now like built in a piecewise manner. Okay, so if you have this direction, you can have the end of the wall of nothing on one side, and here you can have at points several D8 brains, and then this function set is piecewise linear with discontinuities in its first derivative due to the D8 brain tension at the location of the D8 brains. Okay, so these are the domain walls which separate different theories or the same theory with different value of the fluxes until you hit a really bad singularity where the resolution is actually the end of the world. Okay, so this is a more refined way of bringing up the story of Polchinski-Witten to the present setup today. Okay. Now there is a question that I think is interesting, which is what is the difference between this kind of Kobordisen walls that can appear in a theory. You have walls of nothing, and then you have interpolating walls that separate one theory and another theory, or the theory with different parameters. Now, the interesting feature or property is that the difference between the two kinds of walls lies in the behavior of the different fields, and in particular has to do with the Swamland distance conjecture. So let us look at that in some more detail. Okay, so the basic lesson that we learn is that if you have walls in a theory, if you have walls at which the scalars are running off to infinity in moduli space, okay, this happens at finite distance in space-time, but they run off to infinity in moduli space, then the resolution of that corresponds to the Kobordisen walls of nothing. So the space-time will end at those locations. On the other hand, if you have walls at which the scalars finite distance in moduli space, when you reach this wall, then they correspond to interpolating Kobordisen walls. There is some kind of new degrees of freedom that appear quotes, but you can continue through them to a new phase of the theory or to another theory or to the theory with a different set of fluxes or other parameters. But there's some kind of continuation in a sense because you're still at finite distance in moduli space. So you have some place to run in moduli space. And if you hit infinity moduli space, then you have to stop running also in space time. Okay. And this we are motivated by many different examples, including this massive type 2A story, flux calorie of three compactifications, and also non-supersymmetric 10-dimensional and non-critical strings. Okay. I will illustrate this story in a particular setup. And in particular, I will focus on one question just to provide another example and to address these questions. So in the previous dictionary, we found that if you hit infinity moduli space, you have a wall of nothing. And if you remain at finite distance in moduli space, you find this interpointing covertism walls. But there is a question of what would happen if you are at finite distance in moduli space, but you hit a singularity, which may be something similar to what happens at infinity moduli space. I mean, you hit a place where you have extra degrees of freedom, but happening at finite distance in moduli space. What's the outcome of that? Do you interpolate and go through it, or do you have to cut off your spacetime in a world of nothing? Okay, so let us address that question. And one particular setup in which this has already been answered many years ago is to look at M theory compactified on a Calabi-Yau three with a G4 flux. Okay, and this is something which is closely connected to Witten's strongly coupled heterotic. It becomes a Witten's strongly coupled heterotic as soon as you add the Horaba-Witten boundaries, but the discussion is very similar. And in particular, you can borrow Witten's formula and learn that the G4 flux acts as a source, moduli, it's called MBI for the sizes of the different two cycles, and they run on the fifth dimension with a piecewise linear function. Okay, so the story is very similar to the one we had before, but now we have like several functions that control how the different moduli of different color classes, different two cycles run in this extra direction. The whole Calabi-Yau goes to zero, or if the whole Calabi-Yau runs to zero size, then you hit a Horaba-Witten boundary. And if you have M5 then strapped on two cycles, then the corresponding G4 fluxes jump, and you find interpolating domains that separate the theory with different values of fluxes. Okay. And there are jumps for the corresponding Keller moduli with discontinuities in their first derivative. Okay, so it is a bunch of piecewise linear functions that control the evolution of this Calabi-Yau as you move in the fifth dimension. Okay, so what happens if you have an evolution of your Calabi-Yau in such a way that it suffers a flux? Okay, one of the two cycles goes to zero size and then it goes negative formally. So the typical flux transition. Well, this was already studied by Green, Sharma, Xu in already like 20 years ago, and they checked that in this particular setup of Witten's strongly coupled heterotic, which is the same as us in the back, there is a continuous solution across the flop, and they built a complete compact example with two Horaba-Witten boundaries. Okay. The topology change transition as you cross this flop implies that there is some discontinuity in the G4, and then the flop works as some kind of M5 ring interpolating covertism. It kind of carries some kind of M5 ring charge. But it's a wall of something. It's an interpolating wall between the theory at two different values of the G4 flux. There is no end of the wall at this singular point in moduli space. Okay. So the lesson is that if you really have a wall of nothing, this is really dealing with points at infinity in moduli space. So it really has to do with things related to the Swanland distance conjecture. It's not physics of finite distance in moduli space, but rather of infinite distance in moduli space. And next week with the last set of examples. Okay, thanks. This brings me to the last set of examples, which are related to the ones discussed by Irene the other day, which are based on considering general four compactifications of Calabi-Yau threefolds in type 2 theory, for instance, which give rise to 4D n equal 1 theories. And in these theories, Lanza, Marchesano, Martucci, and Valenzuela propose that there is a set of what they call effective field theory string solutions such that when you move radially towards the core of these strings, you attain infinity moduli space when you reach the string core. So basically, the string core is proving for you infinity of moduli space in these theories. Okay, and these strings are characterized by some charge for the different scalars. I mean, in general, you could have several scalars and a vector of charges. In here, I'm just writing just one of them. And you can the conjecture is that in principle you can probe any possible point at infinity moduli space by choosing appropriately this this vector of charges for your actions in your theory. Well, now the observation is that this whole construction can be regarded as a particular example of our setup of a cobordism, dynamical cobordisms, and proving infinity when you reach the wall of nothing. If you look at this angle around the string as a compactification circle, so you look it, you put it like in this cigar like configuration. Now this action monodromy or action shift corresponds to the holonomy, if you wish, or the monodromy that you have on this extra circle. And now the string becomes an end of the world in this direction. So in particular, you can build a dictionary between two configurations where the angle around the string becomes here the compactification S1. The string monodromy for the action corresponds here to some action flux on the circle. And this one can check that it triggers a dynamical tadpole for the corresponding suction partner. So the suction is running in this direction precisely in the same way as they were building because it's just the same configuration. The radial direction corresponds to the coordinate of a running scalar in our setup. And this radial coordinate is of finite extent in spacetime according to our picture. And it hits a wall of nothing precisely when it reaches infinity moduli space. Okay, so all this discussion of EFT string solutions matches very nicely with our picture of cobordism brains giving you walls of nothing, and that they happen precisely when your scalars or your fields Yes, I had a computer crash, so I think it's best that I take up a question. So the next slide was conclusions, and I think the picture
okay,
was
very good.
More or less clear.
Well, let's thank Angel for a nice talk. And Arthur had a question, so maybe we can go on to Arthur's question.
Oh, a very naive, simple one. Do you have a suggestion for the wall ending type 2B in 10 dimensions?
Sorry, I didn't get it.
Do you have a suggestion for a wall that would end type 2B in 10 dimensions?
For type 2B in 10 dimensions?
Yeah.
Yeah, no. I don't have any idea. So for chiral theories, they are not known. I don't have any new insight on that.
Okay, thanks, Anna. So we have a question from Ivano.
Yes. Hi, Angel. Thanks for the very nice talk. I was wondering something about the dynamical tadpoles. So from the Dudas-Murat solutions, and especially their generalizations to, you know, generic P, as we called it, it seems that the end of the world brain, so to speak, is always accompanied by another physical, more standard brain on the other side, or if you wish, at the center of space-time. So usually what happens is that you have to put some kind of brain in the middle, and then the transverse space ends at a finite distance in this end of the world thing. So I was wondering if you think this was a universal feature, or if you could have end of the world brains without other extended objects in the middle.
I don't have the idea about the general picture. So in some cases, we found that you have like two ends and then you end up with some kind of interval. In other cases, it looked like it was enough to have just one of them. And I don't have a good intuition of like offhand say which cases will be realized. So I don't have an answer of when we will have one case or the other. I know that decides that.
Okay, well, thanks.
Thanks, Angel. So if there's, yeah, let's see, Irene, you have a question?
Yeah, very quick. Maybe I'm just extrapolating this too far, but have you thought if you can use it to solve finiteness of the vacua, as Thomas was discussing? Like, I mean, the fact that at infinite distance, you are going to reach some end of the world brain instead of having just many interpolating domain walls. Can it be used somehow to so that you cannot have these infinite tails of different
That's classes? Great. I had a similar question on how, while you're answering, maybe Sakura, you could start to share your screen so we're ready to roll. So yeah, please, Angel, that was a great question.
Yeah, Irene. Looks, sounds an interesting question. I don't know how to address it, but it would be nice to exploit these ideas to address this finest question. I haven't thought about it. It's a good point, thanks.
Great, okay, well, let's thank Angel again. Thanks for a nice